You believe me, don't you?
Of course I do.
Loving yourself is so much more complicated and complex than just a feel-good poster hung up in your office.
You know, cops catch us, they take her away, and they'd split us up.
They can't do that, can they?
I won't let them.
Their emotions are so real and so deep, and their longing for peace and a home and a family is so real and vital and relatable. It really just gripped me.
Irene.
That's her name.
I can count on myself to be there for myself when I need myself the most. If you love movies, that's awesome, but you gotta love yourself. You deserve to have a quality life, a satisfying life. It's one of the many beautiful shades of this experience.
I'm a superhero! I'm a fucking superhero!
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I am Alan Seawright, a professional filmmaker who needs therapy. I'm joined by...
Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies, and today we have a most special and bodacious guest.
Most special and bodacious guest. Back for round two, David, the one and only Dastmalchian. How's it going, man? It's been a while since we've seen you.
Hi, everybody. It's great to be here. Just came through the holiday season, which, as any therapist knows, can be one of the most important times for therapist work, and did well. It was a good one, so I'm happy to be here and excited for a new year ahead and to talk to you guys about movies and minds.
Let's just dive right in.
Love it.
And talk about a very lighthearted film that you wrote called All Creatures Here Below.
Okay, so for those who haven't seen All Creatures Here Below, the basic premise is that there's a couple and they steal a baby. It's like Raising Arizona if it were existential.
Yes.
And there's a lot of heart to it. There's a lot of darkness to it. There's a lot of power to it.
Well, thank you. And I'm really proud of the film. Wrote a script that I was very proud of that dealt with issues that were really personal to me, that meant a lot to me, and that I didn't really know how to navigate psychologically and emotionally, even though I was doing work on it. You know, therapeutically, I think you guys are familiar with this concept, but there's no grading of trauma, whether you have I refer to as like little t trauma, like I was in a bad car accident, no one was killed or maimed, but it still like messed me up. Or my parents had a divorce that was pretty
suffering
traumatic.
Suffering, yeah.
But one of the big T's in my life was the victimization by several generations of my family by a patriarch who was a sexual predator. And I wanted to talk about how, because I've been so moved by seeing how much love can grow in the wake of trauma, and to see how people can love one another in spite of having suffered big T trauma or little T trauma together. So that's all.
Okay, awesome.
Below.
Well, let's take a look.
What are you doing?
Nothing.
What is wrong with you?
Nothing.
What the f***, Ruby? What?
I thought maybe I could get it to work. She's mine now, so I thought it might work.
It doesn't work like that.
You don't know.
I do know. But you gotta be pregnant for that to work. You gotta have a baby.
You don't know.
I do know.
Well, you won't let me.
Dummy.
Don't call me that.
Dummy.
She's so good.
I love you. And I love her.
I know.
And happy. She smiles at me. She knows me.
We're gonna be all right. I didn't used to think that. I thought we were just f***ed all the time.
But you don't anymore. What are we gonna do?
I just gotta do one thing in the morning, and then we're gonna go, the three of us. We just gotta be smart, all right?
Okay.
know, cops catch us, they take her away, and they'd split us up. Forever.
But they can't do that, can they?
I won't let them.
David, if I may, one thing I love about your screenplay is very often people of lower intelligence or lower education are the butt of the joke, right? That's the movie is Dumb and Dumber, right? Which don't get me wrong, I love Dumb and Dumber, but they're the butt of the joke. And these characters, wouldn't say that it's lower intelligence. I would say it's lower development. They haven't had the chance to mature into adults because they've had to take care of each other. Right, the adults in their lives not only didn't treat them well, were flat out abusive.
Yeah.
And they've had to figure it out on their own how to navigate the world, how to survive, and they're just barely scraping by. And what's so beautiful about your screenplay is they may be less developed or less mature, but their emotions are so real and so deep, and their longing for peace and a home and a family is so real and vital and relatable. And it's a film that really just gripped me.
I grew up with somebody who was a survivor, and also there was some definitely developmental issues that had taken place in probably in utero. I'm not sure. I wanted Karen's character, Ruby, in my film to kind of evoke the spirit of Lenny in Of Mice and Men, the Steinbeck character that I think so beautifully exemplifies. And if we look at ourselves through the lens of our development, I didn't do this consciously, but I think looking back on why I needed to make that film and why that story was so important to me to tell, it's like I am in my 40s an individual who oftentimes, much to my chagrin, has allowed my 12-year-old inner self to take control of the steering wheel of my ship. And whether it's because my, amygdala has been triggered or because I'm feeling threatened because I have abandonment anxieties, it's like that thing that lives inside of us that can take over. It happens for both Ruby and Jensen in the film. And I think it happens for all of us to varying degrees. It's such a gift when you get to make a movie, but especially when it's a movie like this, it requires the goodwill of people who are willing to, you know, come forth and work in the hot sun for nothing. So, yeah.
Yeah. This episode is sponsored by PDS Debt Solutions.
PDS Debt rolls all of your payments into one low monthly payment.
Oh man, do I wish PDS Debt had been around 15 years ago, right after I started working in the film industry and launched my credit rating into the sun. And that makes it sound like a good thing. It's not. I burned it to a crisp. It was toasty garbage. Student debt, credit card debt, charge card debt. I bet you don't even know what that is. I sure didn't. That's why I had so much of it. I had stuff in collections. I had all kinds of financial problems.
There were Italian guys threatening to break my thumbs. Like, it was intense.
I never even borrowed from any loan sharks. They just showed up somehow.
I could have used PDS Debt Solutions when I was fresh out of grad school. I wasn't fully licensed, I was working for peanuts, and I was selling my plasma for 2 years.
Literally selling your own body.
Yes!
It would have been better to have PDS Debt help you out. They have customized options for people struggling with credit cards, medical debt, personal loans, collections, scary guys who threaten to break your thumbs, I assume.
No, I don't think that's into that.
We'll look into it.
But how they manage your debt is fantastic.
I know!
You can save thousands in interest and fees and pay off your debt in a fraction of the time.
Anyone with $10,000 or more in eligible debt qualifies, and there is no minimum credit score required.
Plus, PDS Debt is offering a free debt analysis. It only takes 30 seconds.
So head over to pdsdebt.com/cinema and get started on your free debt assessment today. Don't be like Jono and I. Be like people who are smarter than Jono and I. Let's take a 180 degree turn to the popcorniest popcorn that has ever been popped.
He does throw polka dots at people.
Sorry, it's so flamboyant.
It looks cool. I think.
I don't like to kill people, but if I pretend they're my mom, it's easy.
Why did my people not alert me of your arrival?
We didn't see any people.
Yeah, I didn't see anybody. Yeah,
there's no one out there.
I turned them into my mother in my head and killed them.
I turned them into my mother in my head and killed
just
them.
Just having that be the introduction to your powers, and then it's a throwaway joke, is a very James Gunn thing. And then introducing a pretty deep character journey. The question I have for you is, as an actor, how do you approach that?
This is one of those roles, and I say this not to diminish how much work I put into creating Abner with James, but it's one of those roles where I felt like it was written for me, and James said as much in a way of like saying, I have suffered deep depression. I know what it feels like to want to kill yourself. I know what it feels like to believe that the best possible thing that could happen for not only yourself, but for the world at large would be for you to not exist anymore. So to know that that doesn't require anything other than just saying the words that James had written, being as, you know, kind of still as possible and allowing the kind of emotional tenor to seep in was what I needed to do, because he's so great at so many things, but James can just freaking flex tone from beginning to end. And with this film, as crazy and batshit as it is at times, and it jumps all over these different wildly crazy characters, it's still in the same world. The whole time you know you're in this world. So I knew that being in that world, there was just a little tweaks that if I just came as raw and open as possible and allowed the makeup, the costume, the design of the character to do the work. And it's beautiful to see somebody who is so riddled with self-loathing, who is so ashamed, find purpose. Because I think that's what we're all trying to do. In my journey through being an addict and someone who struggles with mental illness and all of the other things that have challenged my life, existing in those realities and doing the work and getting the help that I needed and leaning upon others and learning how to lean upon myself and learning that I can count on myself, which is a big part of the work that I need to do as someone who struggles with abandonment anxieties. All of that work leads now to me. I don't shoot polka dots at people, but I get to tell really kick-ass stories, and I get to like make comic books and movies and television shows that I'm super proud of. And I feel like Abner in a lot of ways, except hopefully I don't get squished by a giant starfish or something.
I'm a motherfucking human!
It's happening to his face again.
Just the thing, I slipped.
Hey, Norman Bates. That's contagious, we need to know.
It's not.
What is it?
It's an interdimensional virus.
What is that?
My mother was a scientist at Star Labs, and she was obsessed with turning me and my brothers and sisters into superheroes. She infected me.
And again, what you're saying on its face is ridiculous, but the total and complete commitment to it is what sells it, makes it funny and sad at the same time. It's just...
What happened to your brothers and sisters?
Some lived, some died.
And your mom, where is she now?
Everywhere.
It's so good.
Oh, man. Your absolute commitment on that everywhere is so gut-wrenching.
Yeah.
And then to have the rug pulled is just so great.
What's great is later on, he starts to step into... She was fully committed to us being superheroes, and I hate her for that. And I hate what she did to us. And you're so restrained, and you're restrained like a person who's been told their whole life they have to be restrained. Sit down, calm down. And so you have this character who's sad, but who also says really morbid, terrible, horrifying things like, I turned them all into my mother and I killed them, with just like flat affect and really calm, right? Because, because and it's you and James Gunn did something really well there, which is you're selling a joke while telling us something profound about the character.
Yes.
And it's all just there in the performance and a couple of words. That's beautiful.
Thank you, guys.
A generation of people with struggles with their mothers related so deeply to that character. So
yeah,
so much of our psychology comes back to our relationship with our parents. Obviously, that's a no-brainer, our childhoods. And for me, becoming a parent, you know, seeing my father in particular, but my mother both everywhere, the different ways in which I was kind of emotionally intermittently abandoned at times, you know, left them looming kind of, and they still loom largely over my process. So if you take that to the extreme, which is the job of a storyteller to do, this character and his arc is like kind of the perfect like metaphor for, I think, somebody who's doing the work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
If you want to see a much longer version of this Psychology of an Actor with David Dastmalchian, you can go to our Patreon, where the episode is over an hour long. We also have additional scenes from The Suicide Squad, and we have an entire discussion about him playing Peter DeVries, the role he plays in Dune Part 1. It is fascinating, David is incredible, there are more stories, there's a lot more heart, and just, this guy is fascinating. You are going to miss out if you're not watching this.
So Boogeyman, this is cool because this is an actual therapy scene.
It is. Yes. I want to get some thoughts from you on the therapy. And your character in this film really only appears in this scene and one other.
Mm-hmm.
But your character is so pivotal to the story. Like, this scene that we're about to watch is the inflection point of the entire story of the film.
So grieving father comes into therapy. Nobody believes him. Here we go.
What were you saying about your children? What happened to your children?
Well, the first one, our baby girl, she died from SIDS.
I'm so sorry. I can't even imagine how difficult that must have been.
You have kids. So you can't imagine.
It's a very pointed comment.
My next... two kids died within a year of the first, one right after the other.
From natural causes, too?
Nothing natural about it. It sucked the life right out of them. Even if the first one was an accident, it still made us susceptible.
Susceptible? To what?
I don't know exactly. I only glimpsed it once. Before my auntie's neck broke. Before they died, my kids, I thought it was just their imaginations getting the better of them. And my oldest, he tried drawing it for me.
This thing that's taken your children. Based on a Stephen King short story, so that should tell you this is unnerving.
A little bit of red up on that paper too, a little bit of blood there.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Great, great production design.
The idea that the boogeyman is
supposed to be
targeting your family.
It's the thing that comes for your kids when you're not paying attention.
Ooh. It's a primal fear right there.
I'm sorry, Pam. Do you mind if I step out? I just need to use the restroom.
Believe me, don't you?
Of course I do.
Chris is so good, man.
I'll be right back.
He's so good.
I love Massimo so much. Uh
oh.
Closet door is open.
Oh my gosh.
Even after you asked for him to close it.
So as a therapist, he nails the when you say you believe me, don't you? And he pauses and then he goes, of course I do. What I love about his performance there is so many times actors overplay the telegraphed I'm lying to you bit. The way he says it is convincing.
Yeah.
I don't have a ton of experience with psychosis, but I do have some. I worked at a mental health agency for several years, and one of the things that I experienced is if you challenge the delusions, the person shuts down.
They put up a wall, yeah.
Because you're saying, you don't believe me, how can I work with you, right?
Right.
Isn't that reinforcing his delusion?
Yes.
You don't attempt to cure your patients.
And make a miserable man out of a perfectly happy horse.
And it's a fine line because you also don't want to feed into them, but the person needs to feel heard. And some therapists will say something like, I believe you believe they're real. I believe you're telling the truth, which is, from the therapist's perspective, I'm being honest, but from the patient, they're just like, oh, it's another
jerk. Just half-assing it. Yeah.
Yeah. And so he plays that really well where he's like, of course I do. Because it feels like he means it, even though he hopes you're wrong. That's how I read the scene. You are unnerving as hell in this scene.
I mean, I definitely did wanted there to be moments, little ticks and little deliveries that made the audience and hopefully Chris's character be like, oh my God, is this guy about to like go off
on me? Is he about to
snap?
This
guy, like how volatile is this man? Like Lester, the character I'm playing, is vibrating with misery.
Yeah.
You're
shaking.
With
grief.
In mourning, in grief. And for anyone who's experienced grief, you know that it can be a feeling of almost possession. It's so hard to feel even safe in your body when you are struck with, like, especially traumatic grief, no prep time grief. Grief comes in so many different, you know, forms. And it's just, we now have a family that's trying to carry on after the loss of their mother. And Lester brings into this home the curse that is what I needed to embody with him. After my character is not in the story anymore, spoiler alert, the family, which is two daughters and their dad, played by Chris, are left in this house in the wake of the trauma of losing their mom, the wake of the trauma of having a man show up who terrified them. And what is so great about the way Rob Savage directed this film and the way they designed it is you've got a father and two kids all dealing with major mental health issues, living in a house where there are three bedrooms all in close proximity to one another, but these people are so far away from each other that it doesn't feel weird or silly that when one of them is under attack, the others aren't rushing in to help. They are so disconnected from each other. And this is what we do to ourselves when we're not doing the work, when we're not getting the help that we need to get. If you're struggling right now and you're watching this, or you know someone that is, and they're not talking to a therapist, they're not communicating with their loved ones, if they're not able to, you know, connect with people around them, you can get lost in the abyss very, very, very quickly. And it's not just dangerous.
Yeah.
It can be deadly.
Yeah.
So the horror of that in this very fun, jump scare filled movie is, to me, quite poignant, you know?
How important it is to seek help and get support, professional, but also just personal.
Yes.
I'll say a lot of the work I've done this year in my therapy journey and we talked about this the last time I was on the show, I don't use acting as a form of therapy. I don't believe in work. Right. I believe in art therapy 100%. I think art therapy is very important. Art therapy is very different than work therapy. I don't think it's fair or healthy for me to show up to work, even if we're making art, and use that laboratory as a place to do therapy, because therapy to me is like going into surgery. And we're talking about your spirit and your brain. For me, so many tools. Taking a 10-minute walk, doing 4-second breaths in, 8-second breaths out, doing my visualization work, literally sometimes sitting and naming all the objects in the room in my head and what color they are, utilizing my other resources as far as contact people. One thing I'm trying to do right now is if I feel a sense of conflict arising and I'm feeling the urge to start talking, to go and write before I start using my mouth. All of those regulation tools are helping me to remind myself the most important thing, which is that I can count on myself to be there for myself when I need myself the most. The reason I don't believe that often when I'm triggered is because my fear of abandonment, that I will be left alone. And I think every character, aside from Piter, And even Piter, if you look at it on a survival scale, believes that fear as well. And that helps to craft, I think, characters that are much more dynamic than just people that want to shoot polka dots out of their fingers or people that want to, you know, inflict ghostly apparitions into people's homes. It's just, it relates so much more to people. And speaking of which, I've got a movie coming to theaters in March that I hope you guys will go see, and I think you'll really dig it. It's called Late Night with the Devil, and I play a guy whose name's Jack Delroy. He's the host of this late night talk show in the 70s, who's basically about to lose his career because Johnny Carson's show was so popular that in 1976, and Night Owls with Jack Delroy was like failing. And he has put so much pressure on himself. He's so afraid that people are going to abandon him if he isn't successful, if he isn't the most popular, if he isn't, you know, the guy. And sadly, he's been so focused on that that during the process of the year that leads to this film, his wife is sick with cancer and dies. And he makes no time to process the trauma of that grief. He just goes right back into work. He's a complete workaholic, alcoholic. And over the course of the film, I had the opportunity to create a character and a performance of a man who is becoming so fragmented that he begins to disassociate in front of a live television audience. And it's whole film, but it's much more to me a drama. And I'm very excited for you guys to see it. I think it's a powerful film, and it will be coming out this spring. So check it out.
We can't wait.
I'm really looking forward to it. Anytime I get to go to a theater and see your face doing something incredible is a good time for me.
Get out of here. Come on.
Accept the compliment.
Thank you.
You got to own this.
I think what you guys do is so cool. I think it's just fabulous. And I hope that everybody who's watching, if you're tiptoeing around the idea of getting into therapy, that you will take the plunge. Take it from me. I'm a person that in some shape or another works with five different forms of therapeutic treatment at the moment. Just know, if you love movies, that's awesome, but you gotta love yourself. And I know that sounds like it's a cheesy thing to say, but like, loving yourself sometimes is so much more complicated and complex than just like a feel good poster hung up in your office. There is so much work. You deserve it. You deserve to have a quality of life. To have a satisfying life, not an easy life. None of us are going to get that. Happiness is
you can have a life that has happiness in it.
Absolutely. It's one of the many beautiful shades of this experience. Well, guys, thank you for having me on. Thank you for doing the show that you do. You're wonderful, and I really appreciate what you do. And, have a wonderful spring of movie watching, and we'll do this again someday soon.
And David, we want to thank you for being on our show because we're huge fans of your work, but now getting to know you, we're huge fans of you as a person and the amount of light and vulnerability and compassion that you put into the world. You're a good man, and thank you for being here with us.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I guess with that, so until next time, watch movies.
Special thanks to all of our patrons who support this show and get all sorts of delicious bonus content, folks like
extra dog content.
That's true.
Folks like Anthony Tran,
Julia Pearson,
Resurrected Hobbyist.
Welcome back, Tiana Horsey Daydreamer,
and Akshay Thakur. Thanks for being patrons and getting extra treats for my dog.
Mm-hmm. You get to watch extra scritches.
Hey, buddy.